Well, this paper follows up quite neatly on the previous one, because it is about pension innovation. Basically, redefining the roles of employers and of insurance companies or pension funds, as we call them in my country, the Netherlands, where I come from. And also it's about some product innovation, namely going from fixed annuities to variable annuities. Now, why do we have this innovation? Basically because the firm is withdrawing as an insurance company. That is the reason why we have this innovation, and we are redefining the role of the employer as an insurer and basically becoming a trustee, maybe helping individuals navigating the financial markets. And as far as the insurance companies are concerned, the pension funds, they're basically becoming mutual insurance, and they have three functions. The first function is that they pool longevity risk, the insurance function. The second function that they have is actually that they have an investment function. People in the fund continue to invest in risky assets. And the third one, actually that they also invest in macro longevity risk. So they take longevity risk on their books. And what is the consequence as far as product innovation is concerned? Well, move from defined benefit to what we call in my country, the Netherlands, defined ambition. Let me explain that word, defined ambition. Defined, it is still the consumption frame. We in the Netherlands continue to think in terms of lifelong benefits, annuities. That means we still pool idiosyncratic longevity risk. We also hedge interest rate risk for the participants. That's the D. Then the A, ambition. It's not a guarantee, it's an ambition, because buying fixed annuities on the markets would be too expensive of a product. We not only want to benefit from the mortality credit, we also want to benefit from the risk premium on systematic risks, like investment risk and like systematic longevity risk. So we are transforming from the B to defined ambition. And I don't want to oversell the case. It's variable. The old times, to have your cake and eat it too, that means to benefit from the risk premium and at the same time have a guaranteed benefit, that time is not going to be back. DB as we know it is dead. Sometimes people in my country say, if we pool risk, the risk will become less. That's true for idiosyncratic risk. It's not true for macroeconomic systematic risks. So that risk you cannot pool. You can only redistribute. And I think that's a very important point. The lessons for the US are as follows. Well, it's a hybrid system we have, so it wouldn't surprise you. DC should become more like DB. It should have more of a consumption frame. It means more thinking about pooling longevity risk and hedging interest rate risk. Take a consumption frame. DB should become more like DC. Employers will no longer misprice the risk. So the risk is on the participants themselves. And so we have to transform, for example, DB public pension funds, transform them into mutual insurers where the risk is with the participants. Well, that's the point of my presentation. So if I don't have enough time, I'm going to go through the Netherlands, through the Dutch experience. Why should you look at the Netherlands? Well, we used to be ranked number one. The Mersing Racing was already said. Well, there's a new kid on the block, the Danes. Why are we ranked first? Why? Because we provide, I think, lifelong benefits in the Netherlands, and we do it privately. And in that sense, we're unique. In the rest of Europe, only the government does this. But we in the Netherlands have private systems that are very important. Why? Because the government only provides the flat benefits. And indeed, we have a strong union movement in the Netherlands, a lot of private collective who provide a social goal, namely providing lifelong benefits. Multi-employer funds that act as self-annuitizing mutual insurers without government help, in the sense no guarantee corporation, there is some help, because the government basically makes it compulsory of all employers and employees to participate in these multi-employer funds. And they are tax advantaged, but only if you buy an annuity. We are a very, very unique country in the world. Here we are the world championship. Sometimes we think about annuities, it's like speed skating. It's like speed skating, you know. You know, we win the gold medal at the end, but nobody is interested anyway anymore. So that's what we think about annuities. But okay. But we are in transformation. This is a transformation of the employer. The employer is withdrawing in one function, namely the insurer's function, stable contributions. They are not the right institution for pension insurance. We have got that in the Netherlands. But we have redefined their role of the employer, and that's to help a number of market imperfections in the insurance market, pool people together, behavioral issues. They still act, help people with their behavior, agency issues to deal with asset managers, you know, not always easy. So, but here's a big problem. And that was that our contract was not complete. It's really unclear who is bearing the risks in this mutual insurer. I think this is the big problem, the governance issues within this mutual insurance company. That is the key issue. And we recognized this during the financial crisis. This is the balance sheet of pension funds in the Netherlands, mutual insurance. On the liability side, they offer guarantees. At least that's how we value them and how we communicate them. On the other side, we have assets. We don't hedge this. The nominal assets that hedge these liabilities are smaller because we want to benefit from the risk premium. But we don't have any risk capital anymore because the premium option has gone. That was the employer who provided the risk capital. And also because of the low interest rates in the Netherlands, we need to market our liabilities to the risk-free interest rate, very low in Europe, in the Netherlands and Germany. So the nominal liabilities have ballooned, the buffer has gone, so there is no risk-bearing capital. And that's why we are fighting in the Netherlands, because nobody wants to take this risk. Retirees have never been told that they were on the hook. And we have cut pensions last year. And also there is a lot of fight about how fast we should cut the pensions. The young say, cut them now, because then there is still something for us in the pot. So this has happened. Trust is almost as high as in the government, in politicians now, because pensions have been politicized. That is the reason. So what have we done? Well, can you address this mismatch? You can do it in two ways. Either you can change your asset side. We don't want to do that because then pensions become too expensive, low interest rates, and too risky. Nominal, nothing for workers, nominal. So what we have done, and that's defined ambition, of course, is to tell people that they no longer have guarantees. They have variable annuities. They be the risk. I'm going the wrong way. Let's see. So now we have, the idea is that we have more of a complete contract. That's at least the proposals, but we are still discussing this. And what are the three problems with moving to such a complete contract? First of all, what to do with the old rights? This is, of course, always difficult. Then we start fighting about how the contract should look like and what the investment policy should be. And most importantly, who should bear the risk? That's indeed the internal governance problems within such a mutual insurance company. There are three conflicts there. The first one is because compromise was that indeed we would invest in risky assets. That's what the workers would like because that would, their contribution rates would stay low. But to please the retirees, we would smooth adjustments. So if there was a negative thing, we would smooth it. So basically, the young are providing the risk-bearing capital. How do we reward them? So the pricing of these things becomes absolutely essential to deal with this conflict. Yeah. The second conflict is between the new participants who buy these variable annuities and the existing ones. You want to price again this contract. And secondly, what happens if the contract changes? These are very long-term contracts. 60, 80 years. They will be changed along the way. Again, pricing becomes essential at that point. Yeah, that's good, exactly at the right time. The lessons for the United States. What are the lessons for you? Well, the DC, I said already, make it more likely to be two big lessons. Keep the employer involved, relieve him indeed from his role as insurer, but keep him involved. And the unions in the Netherlands acknowledge this. They also realized employers can no longer bear this risk, but let him be involved. Let him be involved to address behavioral issues, agency issues, and market imperfections. So let him help with choice architecture, with procurement to the asset management industry, and with the insurance function, pooling the risks. Second big lesson, adopt a consumption perspective, no wealth accumulation perspective. Why is that so important? For risk management, it's absolutely essential that you're not focusing on maximizing your wealth, but that you're actually in the business of creating a lifelong income, absolutely essential. That also, if you adopt a consumption perspective, people want longevities. They don't want annuitized wealth. And of course, that requires that you create homogeneous insurance pools to address the selection issues. And that's exactly the service that employers in the Netherlands perform for the insurance industry. So these are the two lessons for DC. For DB, the lesson is, well, of course, it's unsustainable to have these taxpayers provide these enormous expensive guarantees. So indeed, cut, transform the fixed annuities. They are also in variable annuities, and transform the pension funds into mutual insurers. But there the big issue is, and I guess that's the lesson from the Netherlands, you should value them properly to deal with the internal conflict within these mutual insurers. And this is my last slide. The lessons for pension innovation maybe more globally. Big lesson is, I think we should look very carefully at the various functions in pensions. And there are many of them: asset management, insurance, trustee management, and so on. And if we look at the various functions separately, we may want to combine them in fresh, new ways. Proper combinations of individual elements and of more collective elements. And I have come to the conclusion myself that in the beginning of the lifetime, pensions basically have two main functions, investment function and insurance function. And when you go through the life cycle, it's kind of a life cycle, in the beginning the investment function is more important. At the end of life, mortality credits become important. At the end of life, you go more towards the opaque, inflexible annuity products. But in the beginning of life, I have become convinced, because of the internal conflicts, that it's better to go to individual accounts, which are transparent. The value is very transparent. Also, there's a lot of flexibility, a lot of scope for individual choice, but still keep the employer involved in the accumulation function. That's the first lesson for agency issues and for behavioral issues, and adopt a consumption frame for risk management during the accumulation phase. But then during the decumulation phase, when the mortality credits are important, then you need to transform this financial product into an insurance product, which becomes more a social product. And that product should also look, should take some investment risk, because how do you keep pension cheap? Earn the mortality credit, earn the risk premium, and earn also premium on longevity, because if you nowadays want to insure macroeconomic longevity, it's very expensive. So that are my lessons. Thank you.